Hello and welcome to another episode of Roses Are Red. I'm Bruce Andrews, and in this, the first of two one-half-hour programs, I'm delighted to focus on our very own New England Poet Laureate, Robert Frost. I call this program Seasons of Life. I've been fascinated by poetry throughout my entire life. Some of my earliest memories are of the sound of my mother's voice reading aloud to me. The sounds of her wonderful voice and the rhythm and rhyme of Mother Goose nursery rhymes started it all. Ba ba black sheep, little Jack Horner, Simple Simon still ring in my memory to this day. As soon as I was old enough to read them myself, I was joined by my baby sister, 6 years my junior, to whom I read hour after hour over and over again. We're truly blessed here in New England with outstanding poets. Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, Emerson, Hawthorne, Whittier, born in nearby Haverhill, where I was born, to name just a few. And of course, Robert Frost, my personal favorite. I'm going out to clean the pasture spring. I'll only stop to rake the leaves away and wait to watch the water clear, I may. I shan't be gone long. You come too. I'm going out to fetch the little calf that's standing by the mother. It's so young, it totters when she licks it with her tongue. I shan't be gone long. You come too. Robert Frost is offering us an invitation in this beautiful little poem, an invitation to join him in looking at life through the eyes of one of New England's most beloved poets. And in fact, he is recognized the world over for his wit, wisdom, and natural artistry. This lovely piece, The Pasture, was published in 1914 when he was 40 years old and living in England. The book in which it was published was called North of Boston, and it was his second published book of poetry, the first being A Boy's Will in 1913. So who was Robert Frost? Born Robert Lee Frost on March 26, 1874 in San Francisco, he was named after Confederate General Robert E. Lee. His father was originally from a Kingston, New Hampshire farming family, and his mother was Scottish. He was homeschooled by his mother until 1885 when his father died, and the family moved back east to Lawrence, Massachusetts, to live with his grandparents. They moved quite soon after that to Salem Depot, and he attended school there as his mother was a teacher there. Now let's get back to Frost's poetry, shall we? I've chosen a baker's dozen, more or less, of his poems to share with you, and I ask you to listen with the heart of a lover to his gentle, creative mind as it breathes life into the natural world around us and beckons us to come along for a wonderful ride. I've placed these poems in a sequence I call Seasons of Life, which I hope and pray will become apparent as we proceed. Let's begin our journey into Frost's Seasons of Life with this wonderful sweet poem that reminds us of our youth, our own personal springtime. The birch begins to crack its outer sheath of baby green and show the white beneath. As whosoever likes the young and slight may well have noticed. Soon entirely white to double day and cut in half the dark, it will stand forth entirely white in bark, and nothing but the top a leafy green, the only native tree that dares to lean, relying on its beauty to the air, less brave perhaps than trusting are the fair. And someone reminiscent will recall how once in cutting brush along the wall he spared it from the number of the slain, at first to be no bigger than a cane, and then no bigger than a fishing pole, but now at last so obviously a bowl, the most efficient help you ever hired would know that it was there to be admired. And zeal would not be thanked that cut it down when you were reading books or out of town. It was a thing of beauty and was sent to live its life out as an ornament. Interestingly, this is not a youthful poem, but a much later poem for Frost. It's published in 1947 when he is 73 years old. Now we're talking about rhyming and rhythm here. The birch begins to crack its outer sheath of baby green and show the white beneath, as whosoever likes the young and slight may well have noticed soon entirely white, to double day and cut in half the dark, it will stand forth entirely white and bark. Well, that's a ridiculous way to read the poem, but what I'm getting at is the rhyming. Sheath beneath, slight white, dark bark, green lean. And then in school we may have been taught iambic pentameter, for example, da 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 da, five times, iambic pentameter. But note that reading it properly means you need to follow the punctuation and not the line layout. Let me show you what I mean. The birch begins to crack its outer sheath of baby green and show the white beneath, as whosoever likes the young and slight may well have noticed. Soon, entirely white to double day and cut in half the dark, it will stand forth entirely white and bark. Now, in the same vein as the young birch that we just read, let's look again at the birch tree as a metaphor for life. The next poem is a very early poem published in 1916, more than 30 years prior to A Young Birch, when Robert Frost is 42 years of age and only recently returned from England, where he lived for 3 years with his family, his wife Eleanor, and their four children. He thought that he could be more successful as a poet in England than here in the States. It turned out he was right. When I see birches bend to left and right across the lines of straighter, darker trees, I like to think some boy's been swinging them. But swinging doesn't bend them down to stay as ice storms do. Often you must have seen them loaded with ice a sunny winter morning after a rain. They click upon themselves as the breeze rises and turn many colored as the stir cracks and crazes their enamel. Soon the sun's warmth makes them shed crystal shells, shattering and avalanching on the snow crust, such heaps of broken glass to sweep away, you'd think the inner dome of heaven had fallen. They are dragged to the withered bracken by the load, and they seem not to break, though once they are bowed so low for long, they never right themselves. You may see their trunks arching in the woods years afterwards, trailing their leaves on the ground, like girls on hands and knees that throw their hair before them over their heads to dry in the sun. But I was going to say, when Truth broke in with all her matter of fact about the ice storm, I should prefer to have some boy bend them as he went out and in to fetch the cows. Some boy too far from town to learn baseball, whose only play was what he found himself, summer or winter, and could play alone. One by one, he subdued his father's trees by riding them down over and over again until he took the stiffness out of them. And not one but hung limp, not one was left for him to conquer. He learned all there was to learn about not launching out too soon, and so not carrying the tree away clear to the ground. He always kept his poise to the top branches, climbing carefully with some same pains you use to fill a cup up to the brim, and even above the brim. Then he flung outward feet first with a swish, kicking his way down through the air to the ground. So was I, once myself a swinger of birches. And so I dream of going back to be. It's when I'm weary of considerations and life is too much like a pathless wood where your face burns and tickles with the cobwebs broken across it and one eye is weeping from a twig's having lashed across it open. I'd like to get away from Earth a while and then come back to it and begin over. May no fate willfully misunderstand me and half grant what I wish and snatch me away, not to return. Earth's the right place for love. I don't know where it's likely to go better. I'd like to go by climbing a birch tree and climb black branches up a snow-white trunk toward heaven till the tree could bear no more, but dipped its top and set me down again. That would be good, both going and coming back. One could do worse than be a swinger of birches. My own reflection on this poem brings me back to my youth and my springtime. My father owned a woodlot in Boxford, close to my childhood home in Georgetown, where I grew up. I myself became a swinger of birches when I was young. I have some wonderful memories of wintertime in those woods, climbing as high as I dared, launching out to ride the birch tree down to the snow-covered ground, and then scouting out another tree for another wild ride. Maybe you have similar memories. Here are some notes on freshening our words by Robert Frost. What does he mean by freshening our words? And he says, what I have chiefly in mind is a figurative fetching of fresh words to your use. And at a lecture at Brown and Nichols School, he goes on to talk about that poem. And he says, I'd like to point out to you one or two of the words that I fetched. And I'd like you to consider where I got them, where I fetched them to, and whether I fetched them too far. In this poem, Birches, I'm trying to give you the effect of a similar ice storm, the birch twigs encased in ice. And I wrote, often you must have seen them loaded with ice a sunny winter morning after a rain. They click upon themselves as the breeze rises and turn many-colored as the stir cracks and crazes their enamels. And Robert Frost goes on to comment, there are other words in the poem I like, but where do you think I got the word crazes? And he gets no answer from the students, and he goes on to explain that at the blackboard, he draws a pattern of crackly china like Dedham pottery. And he goes on to say, such heaps of broken glass to sweep away, you'd think the inner dome of heaven had fallen. I wonder if you think I fetched that word dome too far. It's not as good as the other, in spite of the broken glass, but I like it. Now he's commenting on his poetry and fetching words to the class at Brown and Nichols School in 1918. Poetry draws our attention by its sound. It's a symphony to the ear and spirit and response. There is a rhythmic cadence that captures our senses and swings us aloft like the swings and seesaws of our childhood. It's ear candy without the music to distract us. It's sometimes exuberant, sometimes somber or moody, sometimes staccato, sometimes softly unwinding, but always enchanting. Can you understand what Frost meant when he wrote, and I quote, a poem is an idea caught fresh in the act of dawning. You will note that one of the most remarkable things about Robert Frost's poetry is the sound of it being read aloud. That was his desire, and he worked diligently to create sound masterpieces. He once wrote to his friend John Bartlett, quote, the ear does it. The ear is the only true writer and the only true reader. Remember that the sentence sound often says more than the words, unquote. In 1888, at the age of 14, Robert Frost moved on to Lawrence High School in advanced studies and is finally accepted at Harvard in 1891, but can't afford to go. He met and eventually married Eleanor Miriam White, a fellow student at Lawrence. They're married in December of 1895 when he's 21. He's a teacher in Salem, New Hampshire, and becomes a Harvard freshman in 1897 with a scholarship and a wife and a child. By this time, Robert Frost is beginning to write seriously and faces numerous challenges in supporting his family, going to school, and teaching. In 1903, Frost offers his youthful thoughts on growing old. It can sometimes be difficult to look at life with humor, but Robert Frost writes a delightful observation on old age in an unpublished work entitled just that, Old Age. It brings to mind some of my own thoughts on the subject when I was a teenager myself. My old uncle is long and narrow, and when he starts to rise after his after-dinner nap, I think to myself, he may do it this once more, but this is the last time. He lets one leg slip off the lounge and fall to the floor. But still he lies and looks to God through the ceiling. The next thing is to get his outside elbow and so to a sitting posture and so to his feet. I avert my eyes for him till he does it. Once I said from the heart, "What is it, Uncle? Pain or just weakness? Can't we do anything for it?" And he said, "It's specific gravity." "Oh, do you mean by that, that it's grave?" "Oh, no, no, not as bad as that yet, child. But it's the grave coming on." Then I knew he didn't mean seriousness when he said gravity. Old age may not be kittenish, but it is not necessarily serious. He was faced with many challenges as he grew in his personal and professional life. Each challenge required his making a choice going forward. Maturity demands these choices be made, and each of us makes them as we move from our own youthful springtime into early adulthood. This leads me to my next choice of poems that deals with life's choices and how we make the decision to move one way or another when faced with an alternative. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other, as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had worn them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh somewhere ages and ages hence. Two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by. And that has made all the difference. This is another of his earlier works, 1916. If you can stand to reminisce a little in your mind's eye, you could probably come up with a few of your own examples of a road not taken. Perhaps even more than one. Moving along to another one of his signature pieces, we come to the wonderful poem called Mending Wall, with its evocative line, "Good fences make good neighbors." Listen for the personal struggle that Robert Frost faces as he turns that phrase over in his mind. Something there is that doesn't love a wall, that sends the frozen ground swell under it and spills the upper boulders in the sun, and makes gaps even two can pass abreast. The work of hunters is another thing. I have come after them and made repair where they have left not one stone on a stone, but they would have the rabbit out of hiding, to please the yelping dogs. The gaps I mean, no one has seen them made or heard them made, but at spring mending time we find them there. I let my neighbor know beyond the hill, and on a day we meet to walk the line and set the wall between us once again. We keep the wall between us as we go. To each the boulders that have fallen, to each. And some are loaves, and some so nearly balls, we have to use a spell to make them balance. Stay where you are until our backs are turned. We wear our fingers rough with handling them. Oh, just another kind of outdoor game. One on a side. It comes to little more. There where it is, we do not need the wall. He is all pine, and I am apple orchard. My apple trees will never get across and eat the cones under the pines. I tell him, he only says, good fences make good neighbors. Spring is the mischief in me, and I wonder if I could put a notion in his head. Why do they make good neighbors? Isn't it where there are cows? But here there are no cows. Before I built a wall, I'd ask to know what I was walling in or walling out, and to whom I was likely to give offense. Something there is that doesn't love a wall, that wants it down. I could say elves to him, but it's not elves exactly, and I'd rather he said it for himself. I see him there, bringing a stone grasped firmly by the top in each hand, like an old stone savage armed. He moves in darkness, as it seems to me, not of woods only in the shade of trees. He will not go behind his father saying, and he likes having thought of it so well, he says again, good fences make good neighbors. Can you picture these two farmers, each with their own perspective of the same thing? Two different ways of seeing the wall, keeping in or keeping out? Listen to Frost himself as he explains his theory on using our ears to write. The imagining ear, which again occurred at Brown and Nichols School, this would be a 1915, a lecture. Just see and hear the two farmers across the old wall in the spring, picking up stones, placing them back in their places on the wall. Note the tone, challenging and threatening. He says, we have to use a spell to make them balance. Stay where you are until our backs are turned. And then there's the playful note at, oh, just another kind of outdoor game. And then idiomatic balance when he says, he is all pine and I am apple orchard. And incredulity of the other's dictum, good fences make good neighbors? And, but here there are no cows. Shaking his head as he says, before I built a wall, etc. Can't you just see him and hear him on this? So my advice to you boys, in all your composition work is, gather your sentences by ear and reimagine them in your writing. With all the stone walls scattered throughout New England, it's easy to fantasize about those walls being built and the people who did it and their lives as early farmers. From 1916 to 1920, Frost teaches at Amherst College, resigns over a disagreement with the president of the college, only to return 3 years later when the president himself resigns. He receives a Pulitzer Prize in 1924 for his book, New Hampshire. This is his first, but not his last, Pulitzer Prize. He is traveling extensively and giving lectures. University of Michigan is his home base, but he's hardly ever there. In 1929, he and his family move into the Gully Farm in South Shaftesbury, Vermont. But not for long. Let's get back to some great poetry. This next poem is not as well known as many of his others, but if you close your eyes and let your imagination take over, you can almost see the tuft of flowers that Frost is telling us about in this lovely poem called Just That, The Tuft of Flowers. I went to turn the grass once after one who mowed it in the dew before the sun. The dew was gone that made his blade so keen before I came to view the leveled scene. I looked for him behind an aisle of trees. I listened for his whetstone on the breeze, but he had gone his way, the grass all mown, as I must be, as he had been, alone. As all must be, I said within my heart, whether they work together or apart. But as I said it, swift there passed me by, on noiseless wing, a bewildered butterfly. Seeking with memories grown dim o'er the night, some resting flower of yesterday's delight. And once I marked his flight go round and round, and where some flower lay withering on the ground. And then he flew as far as I could see, and then on tremulous wing came back to me. I thought of questions that have no reply, and would have turned to toss the grass to dry. But he turned first, and led my eye to look at a tall tuft of flowers beside a brook. A leaping tongue of bloom the scythe had spared beside a reedy brook the scythe had bared. The mower in the dew had loved them thus, by leaving them to flourish, not for us, nor yet to draw one thought of ours to him, but from sheer morning gladness at the brim. The butterfly and I had lit upon, nevertheless, a message from the dawn that made me hear the wakening birds around and hear his long scythe whispering to the ground and feel a spirit kindred to my own, so that henceforth I worked no more alone. But glad with him, I worked as with his aid, and weary, sought at noon with him the shade, and dreaming, as it were, held brotherly speech with one whose thought I had not hoped to reach. Men work together, I told him from the heart, whether they work together or apart. Speaking of beauty and being able to see it all around you wherever and whenever you are open to it, I personally found that my vision improved enough to see these flowers as I aged and matured to the point where I had time to see, and I was not so busy that I was blind to the beauty around me. This is the patient and lovely beauty of the tuft of flowers in my mind. Well, now we come to something in a lighter vein called Come In. It reminds me of the children's game called Peekaboo, I See You. As I came to the edge of the woods, thrush music, hark. Now, if it was dusk outside, inside it was dark. Too dark in the woods for a bird by sleight of wing to better its perch for the night, though it still could sing. The last of the light of the sun that had died in the west still lived for one song more in a thrush's breast. Far in the pillared dark, thrush music went, almost like a call to come in to the dark and lament. But no, I was out for stars. I would not come in. I meant, not even if asked. And I hadn't been. I can just feel the temptation to come in that the song evokes from my heart, can't you? As we move beyond our summertime years and life propels us beyond midlife to ever greater maturity and responsibility, we may often be tempted to wander from our chosen path to a whispered entreaty that could draw us into the dark and lament. That brings us to a close in this first of two half-hour episodes of the wonderful poems of Robert Frost. Please keep an eye out for the Roses Are Red program listing here on Channel 28 of the Shrewsbury Media Connection, and note when I will continue with Seasons of Life based on the works of Robert Lee Frost, episode 2. Thank you so much for listening. This is Bruce Andrews. Until next time, bye for now.